Many of you already know this young, very good-looking gentleman. Can you demonstrate?
What?
How young and good-looking you are.
Of course. Yeah.
not that way.
Tonight.
All right. His name is Angel. He comes from many countries around the world, so apparently he doesn't have a place to live, right? So he's kind of a nomad, so he goes wherever agility takes him. And he's been here with us for very many times now. I've actually tried to do the math, so
five?
Maybe one hand is still enough? If you have six fingers, right?
So five, six, yeah.
All right. Good. So that's how many times Angel supported our community just to come here, free of charge, imagine that, just to share his wisdom with us, all right? And I think he has all possible certifications when it comes to Scrum Alliance, pretty much like full set. So yeah, I think that's kind of an achievement, right? Any fun fact I need to share with the public about you, or I should stay silent, preferably? What do you want?
I don't know. What? Let's start, because we have
a lot
of stuff.
Exactly.
We have a lot of
time
stuff
is precious. So
okay. So let's start. So thank you very much for being here. Question: how many of you were in my talk last year? Great. So this is the talk last year. Remember, yeah. Forget about Agile transformation. And actually, that this, as you remember, we were talking about the Spotify belt and right, and how risky it is to, when you pretend that you achieve this agility thing just because your boss told you so, right? So when I was invited again to come here into a keynote, I was like, what am I going to say now? I mean, it's the same audience, right? You can have the different audience, same content. Change content is difficult. So I was thinking what to do. Well, first I changed clothes. I put a shirt this time, so I look more serious, right? Because this time I'm going to talk about something a little bit more serious. Actually, I took a superhero shirt. You will see. Can you touch? Touch. It's dry. I will tell you the secret after. Well, so last year I was talking about transformations as a bad idea, and I decided that this year I will talk to you about transformations as a good idea. Right? Are you happy now? How to run agile transformation this year? Yeah? Well, now I think we are ready. Now I think we are ready to understand that transformation is not metamorphosis, right? So we might change within some limits, some boundaries, with, I don't know, like being coherent, but it is something that you can't achieve. Like, so this thing that we are 100 years old bank and we want to look like a small startup. It's kind of this metamorphosis. Sorry, it's not going to happen, right? So we understand, provided that we have seen that difference, we can now have a more like stronger understanding of what we can do, what is actually possible to do, yeah? And for this, I'm going to get a little bit more serious, because we're going to understand this from an integral perspective. We're going to use deep philosophy to understand our work and what are we trying to do in this community and yourself in your companies, as Scrum Masters, as coaches. So for that, first, I will explain you what is integral. So integral theory is a way to explain everything. Absolutely everything that happens in the universe. Yeah? It's a piece of epistemology. We're going to analyze and understand science. With this understanding of context, we will be more conscious about what we do. And for sure, you will be more calm. Yeah? Not thinking about metamorphosis, but instead about progression. Yeah? About evolution. But this is what we're trying to do. Instead of feel frustrated because you want to change the whole world, you want to change your whole organization from one day to another, and then it doesn't happen, and you get sad. Well, instead of that, we're going to understand that there is a progression and it's something that we can do. All right, ready? So now, ready?
Yes.
Yes. So now I need you to turn your brain on and get 1,000% of your attention, because this is going to be really difficult. I promise you. It's going to be really difficult. You will need to squeeze your brain. Yeah? And this is important to me, because usually when people don't understand things, they don't say, I don't understand. They say, this is shit. Right? So please, please focus, because this is difficult to understand. Are you with me?
Yes.
Very good. Okay, so let's start from the beginning. The first concept is hold on. First concept of integral theory is hold on. That means every system is a whole and is on a bigger system, is part of a bigger system. Yeah? Yourself are part of the team, your team is part of a department, the department is part of an organization is part of a country, a domain, so on and so forth. So it's important for you guys to understand what is your whole on. Yeah? So your area of influence, if you want and can influence a team, an organization, a country, because if you try to understand everything at the same time and influence everything at the same time, more probably you will get frustrated, because it's impossible. Yeah? My boss should understand, the management should understand, politicians should understand. Yeah? This leads to frustration. Understand what is your area of influence. Yeah? Because this is a subject of study. First concept. Second concept, quadrants. What is quadrants? And this is why you are standing up right now. All right, so do we have developers here? Can you please raise your hands? Developers, very good. So please, developers, go to this side of the room. Please come here. All developers here with me. All developers here. Run. This quadrant, from this column to the end of the room, developers standing up here. Okay. Applause for developers. Woohoo! Because they actually do things. They do things. So these people work on the intentional, they're experts on the intentional part. Yeah? Which is their craft. Yeah, they are good at developing skills that can be developed individually. Yeah, and the craft is very important for them. Be good at what they do just themselves. Yeah, these intentional people. So this is your quadrant, intentional guys. All right. Well, we are actually. These guys are very good at developing intentional ability, which is craftsmanship, something that depends on them, on their craft, on their abilities, individually. Yeah? They are very good at creating and following standards. And this is something that human beings, well, when I put it in this quadrant, human beings learn to do with guilds, right? We have craftsmen, they are very good at something, and they try to create these standards to be shared between people that have the same specialty, yeah? This is when we create the standardization and we put focus in history in the intentional quadrant. All right, so next, please, how many of you are like project managers or managers that you ensure that results happens? Please raise your hands. Project managers, very good. So please, project managers, stand between this and this column. Come here. Applause for project managers. Please come here. Woo! Fast. Very good. So this is the behavioral quadrant. Yeah, this is the behavioral quadrant. These people are good at ensuring that things happen in an efficient and productive way. Yeah? They are good at engineering, improving processes, understanding practices, and turning what is a complicated work into something that is possible to manage. Yeah? This is the behavioral capability. And this is something that human beings, we invented during the economy of scale. Yeah, it's very good, because it's a great way to get consumers to benefit from products that otherwise would be extremely expensive to get. Yeah? So this is what these people is important. Yeah? Very good. So how many of you guys are focused on customers? So you work in market management, marketing department, in the business side of the company, product discovery, product development, you're entrepreneurs. How many of you work like that? Product oriented, product. You care about products. Yeah? Well, it's okay, you can change. It's okay, you can change. So please, here, let's keep the product oriented people. Product oriented people. So we try to understand the customers, yeah? Here in this side. Feel free to change quadrants if you want, yeah? So here we have product. So these people here are very good and focus on understanding what the customer wants. Yeah? Cool. Okay, please applause for them. Because they are good at the social contribution of the company. Yeah? So how this company, how this Holong interacts with another Holong, so that they get the feedback and they react to this feedback. Yeah? So it's Holong to Holong communication. This is the social part. Yeah? It's gonna put it here. Okay. And these people actually, they should be very good at this ability that we call agility. Agility is no other thing than the capability of an organization to be flexible so that they adapt to their customer needs. It's no other things. If you guys, this is very important, if you guys are doing Agile, Scrum or whatever, and your final customer is not noticing any difference, sorry, but it's useless. Final customer should notice the difference. Otherwise, I don't care if you do Scrum, Safe, Less, whatever. Congratulations, tell you to your mama. But this is useful only for company to react in a different way to the customer needs. Yeah, and this is what we call Agile. This is the effect that we want. Sorry, not about productivity or anything else. Remember from the last talk, productivity, you want faster software, Red Bull, or cocaine, another option. Yeah? Very good. But that's not Agile. Agile is about experimentation. We all know that, right? This is the social quadrant. And actually, this become very important now because there are a lot of products in the market. Yeah? Now we have a new product every month, or even less. That's why either you are good at customization or you disappear. We are currently in an era in which the market is demanding this kind of capability. This kind of ability is becoming really important now in this moment of history. And this is why we're here. Yeah? This is the present of the industry, and this is why Agile is important now. Because the customer is demanding this. Yeah? Before it was demanding that. Before it was demanding cheap. And before it was demanding good. Now demands cheap, good, and customized. It's normal. What is going to happen after agility? So, how many of you here are focused on human development? Coaches, professional coaches, scrum masters, yeah. Agile coaches, HR people. So please stand in this side of the room. And if now is your moment to choose if you want to change. So please distribute and choose the place that fits best for you. Okay? So change. Put whatever you think, change if needed, put whatever you think is best for you. Human oriented, customer oriented, project oriented, and craftsmanship oriented. Cultural ability. Yeah. Well, cultural ability is very important because it allows us to be able to absorb disruptive changes. People to leave the company when something goes wrong. People to go crazy and scared when they had problems. People not to be able to communicate or be transparent. Or people leaving the company when there is a political or business crisis. Yeah, this is why these people is here. To keep the organization strong and resilient. And this is going to become every time more important And this is what comes after Agile. In the future, I think that businesses will be disrupted all the time. So now we have this. We have these companies that change the rules of the game. They change like Airbnb or Uber or Lime. There are many companies that literally change the rules of the game. And making organization able to absorb that change is critical for the organization not to disappear. This is one of the capabilities we need to create in organizations to be more resilient. This is what comes after agility. And there are two elements that we should do in order to make that happen. One is simulate those changes to earn the capability. We are going to learn more about what is this simulating. And the other is about the diversification. Startup nursery. I think that in the future, companies, big companies, will be nursery of small companies. Why? Because if disruptive change happen and this dies, it's not a problem. You will put a new one, right? Diversification is what we do when we have places that are potentially chaotic. Such as, for example, stock options. You diversify, yeah? So these people is important for that. For resilience, to create resilience, create the cultural ability to absorb disruptive changes. Yeah. All right. So now we have the quadrant. Understood? What is the quadrant? Yes. Yes. Because all organizations need to focus on this quadrant. If you forget about one single of this quadrant, your organization is potentially being destroyed very soon. If you build something and this thing that you build doesn't work, your organization is potentially being destroyed. If you build something that is costly, too costly, organization needs to make money, so can be potentially destroyed. If you build something but nobody buys it, nobody wants it, potentially the organization can be destroyed. And if something bad happens, something that you expect, that you don't expect happens, and people leave the organization, or customer leave the organization, or stakeholders or shareholders leave the organization, organization can be destroyed. So that's why all organization needs all these people and all this capability. We are agile, forget about management. No. You need standards, you need engineering, you need to understand the customer, and you need to care about people. If you forget about one of this, organization will be destroyed. I promise you. Yeah. So they will help us understanding how to make a balance grow in your organization to happen. This is what we're doing here. We're not transforming organization. We're getting more of this. That's it. Because now we need a little bit more focus on this part here. That's it. For that, we're going to understand the next concept, which is lines. Yeah. The lines are the possible things that we could do to improve in each of these capabilities. Yeah. And for that, we are going to do a small exercise, right? I'm going to put here some paper, here, and here. Please come, pick a piece of paper, and write down what your organization is doing in order to improve your area. So what your organization is doing in order to improve people interaction, what the organization is doing in order to improve interaction with the customer, what your organization is doing in order to be more efficient and productive, what your organization is doing in order to be better at software development. Yeah, so pick a piece of paper, write down, and put it here. So those are the lines. Go. 5 minutes. All right. Good. So this is a very, very important element. This is a very, very important element. Because in my experience, if you want to be successful on implementing any practice, any technique, any framework, you need to be super, extremely clear about what do you want to get out of it. Yeah, you don't want to do pair programming. What you want to do is you want to increase the skills on development of your people. Yeah. In 10 years, if the organization is still alive, I'm not sure that you will still be doing pair programming. But for sure, the developers will have improved their skills. And you keep that ability. And this is what we're trying to do in organizations, creating abilities, and they keep them. Yeah? If you decide to deliver frequently, yeah, to reduce the risk, now we call it Scrum. But in 10 years, I don't know if you're doing Scrum. I'm sure that in 10 years, you will understand that deliver frequently reduces the risk, and it makes it more efficient and productive. You keep that capability and understanding. Now, I'm not sure if you will be doing design thinking or not in 10 years. Maybe there is something better. But for sure, you keep the ability of understanding that connecting with the customer is critical for the success of your business. That capability stays in the organization. You want that. You don't want the practice, you want the purpose. And this should be very clear. Here we might do retrospectives. Yeah, retrospectives are cool, but you don't want to do retrospectives. In 10 years, I don't know if you're doing retrospectives or constellations or something different, or team coaching. But for sure, if you do retrospective now, organization will care about people interactions. And that you keep in the organization. So you want to keep resources in the organization. You don't want to implement practices. And the purpose should be extremely clear. Why? Because that will reach, that will help organizations reaching different levels on the understanding of each of these capabilities. So let's talk about levels. Please think about the practices that your organization is or is not doing, okay? This that you were writing, or those that you wish to write, but maybe your organization is not doing and you feel, So we're going to vote on how strong do you see your organization in your quadrant. So if you feel that my organization is really bad, for example, at the interaction with the customer, I will go like this. If I think that medium, like this, not bad, good, super good, woohoo, yeah? So vote for your organization. How good is your organization at your quadrant? So please do it. Please vote with your body. Go. Don't be shy, don't be shy. How good do you see your organization? This is bad, really bad, super bad. You can lie down on the floor, this is super good. Don't be shy. Don't be shy. Share how good is your organization. Like this. Here, good, average. Very good. I don't know. I don't know means bad. Okay, good. Okay. So see the landscape. See the landscape. Those are the levels that your organizations have in each of these areas. Yeah? So you can see something like this. Yeah? We might be very good at at this skills improvement and the standardization part. Super good at productivity. We put a lot of focus on that. But about understanding the customer, not so much. And people in the middle. For example. Yeah. So this is your levels. Yeah. So from this you can, but please do this drawing, see your perception on how much effort do you put on each of these quadrants. Because usually what happens is not that my organization is broken. My organization is stupid. It's not stupid. It might be unbalanced. It might be unbalanced. You're putting too much effort on something and forgetting about something else. And that is risking the continuity of your business. That's the problem. Yeah. Well, this is no more an copy-paste problem. Or maybe you start already with the beers, because I see it right. It says stages, it's you that you... But this is stages. So this is your stage. This is how you are now. This is your stage. Well, the thing is, we have a dream. We want the organization to be in another stage in which they put maybe more effort in these areas. This is what we want to do. And why? What is the purpose? Oh, we want to do Agile. You don't want to do Agile. You don't want to do Scrum. You want to be able to understand your customers and react accordingly. You want to be more resilient. You want to take care of people so people won't leave when problems happen. This is what you really want. Yeah? Agile is a tool. You want to go to a future state. A future state. More evolved. So you want to develop specific capabilities in those areas. For that, it's important to connect with the purpose. Are you following me? I know this is complex. I know this is very weird. Yeah, can you give me a recipe so I become agile? No, it's more difficult. Yeah, evolution. And it gets even more difficult because in my experience, what happened is many organizations struggle to implement agility because they never been there. They never experience it. So how can you reach something if you never experience or see it happening? Follow me in the Agile transformation. Follow me. Where? I don't know. Just follow me. This is going to be better. People will be more motivated. Happy innovation. Sounds good. But I'm a manager. I'm sorry, man. I listen this story every day. Lean would make things better. Product manager would make things better. Project management would make things better. The new framework, the new technology will make things better. Yeah? Well, we never been there. So the only way for to get organization evolved to a different stage is through experimenting that state. How do you feel now? Maybe tired, right? A little bit tired. You're standing up. This is on purpose, yeah? Energy now is low. You're in a state in which you're tired, yeah? Can we put music for a second here? Well, or no? DJs? No, I can't sing, no. It's possible? Organization left. It's okay, we can do it without music. Yes. Jump, okay, it's okay. Oh, it's okay, we can do it. Just jump with me a little bit like this. Yeah, go stronger. Breathe from the nose. A little bit more. Okay. How do you feel now? Your heart is beating stronger, for sure, right? Can you feel your heart? What changed? I put you in a different state. You were in a state of tiredness. Now you're in a state of energy. But actually you've been there already. Yeah? But imagine someone who never been energized. And you explain him about energy. He's not gonna understand. And this is why we do open spaces. This is why we do hackathons or exploration days, or we do pilots of Scrum teams. So we get the organization to experience the state. But use that as an experience. So don't get frustrated when the organization tries Agile and then comes back. It's normal. They were only experiencing the state. They come back, use the knowledge, ask questions. What did you get? What ability did you got after this? How can you use it? When do you need it? We don't want to do metamorphosis for the organization. We want the organization to get resources so they can use when they need. For that, we need to experience the state. Are you with me?
Yes.
Very good. It's also important that we understand the type. So there are conditions that influence the possibility to experiment the state. Big organization is not the same as a small organization. Video game company is not the same that a bank. McDonald's is not the same like Google. And we need to understand that to prevent this. Understand who you are being, who the organization has been trained to be, and work from there. From your current state, in your current stage, experience the state for the next evolved stage. Are you with me? All right. So in practice, oh fuck, this is super weird. This Spanish guy is so crazy. The state type now make me jump. What can I do? Are you feeling like this? Like confused? No? It's normal. So what can I do? Okay, I will give you a small recipe because I know you want a small recipe. No, okay, I don't want to understand. That's, tell me, what should I do? Okay, I will tell you what should you do. Maybe you work with a team. Maybe you work with a department. Maybe you work for an organization. When you do performance appraisals, you do performance appraisals, or you have objectives, create the proper objectives. Start from there. Create the proper objectives. In the organization, you have an objectives strategy. Let's put one per quadrant. Organization tends to put objectives that are only in these two quadrants. Yeah? And they are, listen, this is very important. They are appraised by one single person. In reality, that means that the people will work to make his boss happy. According to something tangible in the behavioral quadrant, or something that involves skills improvement in the intentional quadrant. And we forget about that. We mention that, but we forget. So if you put goals, put one in every quadrant. Here you have an example. Yeah, write readable code, reduce lead time, very good. But also how teams interact with each other. You can find that is something that is really oriented to humans, something that is oriented to collaboration. It's okay. Yeah, and also about the customer. Include that, just include that. Include four objectives, one per quadrant. Skills, delivery, customer, and human interaction, yeah? First tip. Then define 1-3 actionable metrics for goals. Well, that's not all other thing than just the lines, yeah? You have a goal, and then you have three metrics. Yeah, here you have examples, like chromatic complexity, theme throughput, how cross-functional we are, or the net promoter score from the customer. And put the same focus on all of them. Are you with me? Four objectives, three indicators, per quadrant, per objective. Next element, get the right people to measure and evaluate the result. If everybody has to please their goal, their boss, and the boss is the only one measuring, this is not going to happen because the boss might not have these results in their appraisal, in the performance appraisal, yeah? So we want to make the people themselves happy. Make the boss, the manager happy. Make the customer happy and make the rest of the team happy. So that's why we need this part to be evaluated, the intentional part to be evaluated by the people themselves, how I improve my skills. This part here evaluated by the management. This part here evaluated by the team. And this part here evaluated by the final customer. So if I make myself, my team, my manager, my customer happy, I'm contributing to the continuity of my business. Next, nurture a balanced growth. Nurture a balanced growth. What does it mean? We need to understand that we need to put equal focus in all these four quadrants. So if we measure four, but we give the bonuses on people, or we do performance appraisals on people based on only two, people will just look at those two. This is very important. It's also very important that we redefine often and review very often, because the system is in continuous transformation themselves. My rule of thumb is define every quarter, review every month or less. Yeah? To ensure a balanced growth in these four dimensions. It's very important that we have two that are evaluated team level and two that are evaluated individual level. Yeah, as you've seen here. My contribution in these two areas and our contribution in these two areas. Because if you only measure individual performance, people won't work as a team. And if you only work or only encourage team performance and measure team performance, people won't take individual responsibility. So you have to measure both. So that's what I learned. That through objectives and pursuing this improvement, you get the capabilities that Agile is intended to build in your organization. But Agile is just a way, it's not a purpose. You're just trying to build this future state. You want to experience these future states and turn it into your stage of development. Organization is better, have more resources connected to understanding of a customer and human interactions. So to evoke this transformation, you need to experience the state to get to the next stage. It's not revolution, it's an evolution of organization due to social evolution. Thank you.